Hello, we're going to do a little watercolour today and we're going to do a still life. It's something that's a good practice, especially when you're a beginner. And I've chosen just to do three very simple objects. And it's a good idea when you set off just to do one or two, you know, to begin with. And think about the objects that you're choosing. I mean, it used to be in still life that things would maybe have some symbolism and you know, they can be very elaborate. But to set off with, if you do a simple one, just choose things that you would naturally find together. My son sent me this tin of biscuits for Mother's Day and he said, I thought this would be something nice to draw in a still life. So that's what I've done. So to go with the tin of biscuits, I've picked a teapot and a little cup. Now, my drawing isn't absolutely brilliant. I've done it quite quickly. And as you can probably tell by most of my work, I do tend not to do anything in too much detail. So I've left some of the lettering off the front of the tin and one thing and another, because it was more, I really wanted just to talk to you about getting a composition and the importance of doing still life, really, because it makes you look, you need to observe. So that was the thing about it. And I'm just gonna pop a little picture here now for you to have a look at. I've taken a picture of my whole table. Because you need your still life to be quite a distance from you. Don't have your still life right here, right in front of you. It's very difficult to draw it at that distance. Put it a little bit further away, even if that means you need another table further away than where you're working from. So get that distance, and when you're putting your objects together, don't just plonk them on the table. Think about where you're positioning them. Here I've put the teapot, it's a bit of a jaunty angle, it's sort of pointing towards the biscuit tin with his little spout. I've actually got it a bit wonky, but it doesn't matter really. But it's pointing back into the painting, and we've got a few different heights. We've got the biscuit tin at this height, and then, you know, a couple more heights coming down. And I've left a little gap between the biscuit tin and the cup, so we've got a bit of space there. So think about the spaces in between. And when you're drawing, if you look, you would see me when I was doing the drawing then, just in the introduction, you would see me measuring all the time. So I'm just comparing the measurements. So compare the measurements of each object to each other, but also the spaces in between. So look at these shapes here. So the shape of this and the shape in between here. If you look back at the picture, not at the picture, at the still life, just check those measurements all the time. Again, I've got the cup a little bit jaunty as well, they're going that way, but it's a bit of fun, isn't it? It doesn't matter. So the idea was to just show you how to do a little watercolour. So those are the main things. Think about getting an interesting composition with a few different heights, things pointing back into the picture if you can, just to make it a nice little shape. So think of the whole thing as a shape. We've got a triangle there, haven't we, really? Don't just think of them as individual objects. Think of them as a picture that you're bringing together, and keep that distance between you and your objects. Okay, so I've done the pencil quite heavy, so hopefully that you can see it. And we're now gonna start and put some watercolor on. So the biscuit tin itself is a lovely, lovely colour actually, but I'm not quite sure how we're going to do it. It's a very, very pale green. So obviously to get a pale green, you use the white of the paper, so plenty of water. And whilst I'm painting, I think I will stop recording my voice, and I might do a little voiceover afterwards, because I've sort of told you what I wanted to tell you to begin with. And if there's anything else I want to say, I'll pop some notes on top or maybe do a little voiceover. Okay, so I'll continue now with putting the watercolour on. Okay, so you can see I've just used a couple of colours there, and to start with I've been mostly painting sort of wet onto dry and then just adding a little bit of extra pigment in where I wanted some shadows. So that was just a sap green and some cadmium yellow, and this was Payne's grey, both of them used with plenty of water to give us those really pale colours. Now the object of this really is to keep looking back, so all the time I'm looking at where the highlights are and where the shadows are, and there are an awful lot of highlights and shadows because of the different light sources. So actually sometimes when you want to simplify it, you perhaps want to just look at where the main ones are. You could actually spend a week doing this, getting all the detail in. And obviously you're gonna have more time than I have to make a more detailed drawing. But just keep looking back and keep seeing where those shadows and highlights are, because it's those that are gonna bring it to life, getting the shadows in. So now I'm going to carry on, and before I do any more detail on these, we're going to have to let them dry a little while before we put any more detail on. This has bloomed a little bit here. It's not the greatest paper, it's only very light paper that I use for demonstrating on. So hopefully if you have a better paper than that, you're not going to get this effect. But actually it's okay, because there's a shadow coming across the tin there anyway. So once it's dry, I will put some extra layers on, put even more shadow in, to bring out the highlights. So I'm gonna, before I do anything else, put some shadows in underneath. This is very important because you need to look, make these objects look as if they're actually sat on the table. You don't want the objects to look as if they're floating in space. And that's one of the reasons that I've sat them on a white piece of paper. You might have noticed that in the photograph that I showed you. They're sat on a piece of paper. So it's much easier then to see the shadows underneath. And they've actually got a light right above them, which is casting quite a distinct shadow of this teapot. So once you've got the shape of the shadow in, then just look and see if you've got the tone right. If I look at it, actually it needs to be a little bit darker. And of course with watercolours, again, don't forget that this is going to dry lighter. I've just got a little hair there, I'll just get rid of that. Eyelash or something. So now we can't really see where the bottom of the teapot is and where the shadow starts, but that what later on we're going to make it darker along here, because right underneath the teapot it's very, very dark, but we want that to be quite a crisp line, so I'm going to do that when it's dry. And again we'll look at the shadow in the, a little bit of extra water in the shadow of the biscuit tin, and again it's much darker just underneath, and we'll come back and put that in when it's dry. So just getting them more or less in the right place at the moment. And this one, and sometimes you'll have more than one shadow. If you've got, you know, often in kitchens we have these spotlights from above, and then we might have another light source from a window, so you could end up with a couple of shadows overlaying each other. So just look very carefully at where they are, and again try to simplify them if they're very complicated. So you can see already that's making them look as if they're sat down, and I'm going to do actually going to put a line in for the edge of the table as well. And we'll just do that in, what colour should we use? Just quite a neutrally pale colour for the imagined edge of a table. And even though we're not painting here, just carry your brush through so that when you get to here, you know whereabouts it should be. And the same at this side. Just get a touch of water. can bring it down to meet those shadows. And can you see the shadows running into the table colour? But I'm not going to worry about that because, of course, the shadow is on the table. They're not two separate things. So I will just let those flow into each other a little bit while they're still wet. Much more natural feel to the whole thing. And this is a raw umber that I'm using, I should have said. And even where you're going around the object, if you just try and keep your brush going in the same direction to give that impression that it's the grain of the wood of the table going across in that direction. You can even leave some gaps to give you that more of an impression, rather than going all around everything with your brush. Keep them all going in the same direction. Okay, and to do the above that, I'm not sure what colour we'll use above that. I think something a bit sunny should we do. I'm going to just turn my page around. It makes it so much easier than trying to paint over the top of what you've already done. And because we've already used the cadmium and because we want it quite sunny, I think we'll make some yellow up. And we'll just go over that where the handle is, because we're going to paint that in later and it'll be a darker colour than the cadmium anyway. And again, I'm keeping all my brush strokes in one direction, not going up and down, going across. You'll notice when you're watching me demonstrating that I'm always running out of paint. It's very easy for me not to practice what I preach, but you really should have enough paint made up to begin with to get a nice flat wash. I'm always just making colours up as I go along, making more. But that all comes with practice. Okay, I find it easier if I have it right way up again. So that yellow's really cheered things up, hasn't it? So I'll just put an extra bit in here. And again, just where it's dried out there, just adding some lines on top, maybe even a bit of dry brush, just gives the impression that it could be some wallpaper or something behind. And I think actually I'll just add a bit more water to this yellow, but I would like to bring it into the foreground as well, because it would probably be reflecting somewhere along there. And it's going to be reflecting also, if we've got yellow there, it's probably going to be reflecting on the teapot, isn't it? So let's get that colour throughout the painting. Okay, and then I'm going to leave it to dry now before I put any more detail into it. Okay, so now that's dry, we can be a lot more detailed with it. Like I say, you're going to have more time to fiddle about and get all this detail in. I'm leaving the wording and things off the biscuit tin, but you could put those in. So I'm going to start at the top of the painting. It's much easier to start and work down so that you're not dragging your hand over things. If you look back at the picture I did show you of the actual objects themselves, these colours really now aren't bearing much resemblance to what I've got on the table. But that's artistic license, isn't it? I've decided that I want to keep a limited palette to make a little harmonious picture. So silver is very difficult to draw. It's basically usually use whites and greys. I'm just putting a little bit, so again, because I've used the Payne's grey for the shadow, I'm using the Payne's grey for these silvery bits. of metal. So the thing to give that metal effect is to leave some white. So can you see I've left that white of the paper from before to give us a little shine on that metal. So there's actually a metal rim under the tin as well here. Now at this point you could get a much smaller brush to use and get even fiddlier, but if you use a big brush it keeps you quite loose and your painting doesn't look as overworked perhaps sometimes. But if you want the detail then you carry on and get smaller and smaller brushes and get all that detail in. I'm just going to go for the overall sort of look and feel of the thing. Even here I'm just quickly drawing the basic shapes that I'm seeing of that fastening there, and again leaving some white paper so we've got the feel that that could be some metal, shine on the metal. And now a little bit more of the Payne's Grace. Like I said before, because there's absolutely no light getting underneath the tin, you've got quite a sharp shadow line here. And the same under the teapot. Then look actually on the teapot and see where the darker spots are. And the darkest spot on the teapot to me is here. It's obviously not catching the light under that little handle. And the shape here. And there's quite a rim on this, which again is causing a shadow. Down here as well. So just keep looking back and seeing where the darkest areas are, and like I said before, maybe just simplify it, just put the most obvious ones in to begin with. You could stay here all week and put them all in if you really wanted. Before I put any more detail of the shadows on the cup, I'm going to actually put a little bit of colour on the cup, because I do feel at the moment we need a little bit of extra colour in this painting. So on the cup itself there's some pink and blue flowers, so I'm going to just get some pink. This is a light red, and I'm not going to fiddle about drawing every little flower. I'm just going to draw some little shapes, roughly in the shape that they are. And then those are on the saucer as well. And the blue ones. So for the blue, we'll use a cobalt, I think. Just a small amount. And just pop some random patterns in really. And I'm going to go back to the shadows on the tin, and I'm going to mix up more of the green and the yellow, which is the colours we began with the tin. And again, go back to putting more shadow. So we'll look so this time putting the shadows in painting wet on dry, so that we've got some nice crisp edges to give us the shapes of the tin as well as the shadows. It's going to just help reinforce that shape. Don't lose all the white, because it has got a lot of highlights on. So as you're painting, imagine you're painting around the tin. If you're not sure about painting cylinders and ellipses or drawing them, you could have a look at the video that I did on drawing wine glasses and wine bottles. I'll put the link for that up here. And it just talks through really about getting that 3D shape of something like this biscuit tin that's a cylinder. Although that side of the biscuit tin is actually quite light against the background and against the teapot, I'm putting extra in because it was, the edge of it was lost. So sometimes you've got to alter things around to suit the picture. Don't be completely tied by what's in front of you. If you think it requires something extra or something changing to make the painting overall look better, then do it. And I'm actually now going to get a tiny bit of the green with a little bit of water and pop some onto the front of this teapot here as well, because the teapot is going to be reflecting because it's so shiny, those colours. And that's going to dry quite that's going to dry quite pale, so don't worry about it looking too green at the minute. And again, if I'm looking at it, I can see the colours from the table in there. And hopefully now this cup's a little bit drier, we can go back to that with some more shadow. So under the rim here, it's actually sort of a bit wonky, that rim. And it has lines going down, which is all going to help give the impression of a saucer. And then underneath, it's very dark, obviously. No light hitting under there at all. And under the rim of the cup itself, so it's going to be dark. And here, okay, so I'm going to leave it at that. You might have more time to do a more detailed drawing. and a more detailed painting, in which case you might want to use some smaller brushes, like I said before, and put extra detail on with the wording and things. So you really could go on forever looking at all those shadows and highlights and reflections, because there's three things to think about there. So that's why I've simplified it, really, to show you that you can make a nice, pretty little picture without worrying yourself about doing every little last detail. So leave the white of the paper for the highlights. Don't be afraid to go really dark for the shadows, and that's going to give you some contrast and make your picture quite interesting. So enjoy your watercolours. I hope you find that useful. If you've any questions, put them in the comments below, and I look forward to seeing you again soon. Thank you. Bye for now.